Thank you so much, Dave, for leading in this morning, and Paul for the good prayer, and appreciate so much your presence today, and I hope you had a wonderful Thanksgiving, that you got to spend a little time with some family, and maybe eat some sweet potatoes and turkey or whatever it is. I've eaten sweet potatoes and turkey for 3 days now, and whatever left over, we just keep trying to eat, and it sure is good. But we're very thankful for our families, and I know this year was different. This year was totally different for many families versus the way it has been done in years past, where you'd have 50 to 100 people at one house and everybody's in the yard and spilling over. I mean, so things are different, and things have been different. But, you know, even though they're different, should not take away from us the idea that we should be thankful. And, you know, that's kind of what Thanksgiving's about. It's a time to really be thankful for all that God has given us. You know, sometimes we think about this Thanksgiving being all about interaction between humans, but really it's our thankfulness to God. Which, if I'm really thankful to God, that spills over into me being thankful to others. But let's think about Thanksgiving. Let's think about what it truly means to be thankful. And, you know, to begin with, a child of God, if I'm going to be a child of God and be the child of God that He wants me to be, I must be thankful. How can I be a child of God and not be thankful? Is it possible that I can be forgiven of my sins and to be given this new life to walk in Christ and to have all the spiritual blessings that are in Christ, and yet I'm not thankful? Is that possible? When you stop and think about it, is there any way that is possible, feasible? That I can have all the blessings of God, everything that He has given to me, the forgiveness of my sins, the adopting me into His family as a child of God, the changing me from the inside out to where I'm a better person, to where I live better, I act better, I am better. Can I have all those things and yet be an unthankful and ungrateful person? That's hard. I can't figure that out. It's like taking oil and water and pouring them together. What happens? It don't mix. It's going to stay separated. So how can I say that I am a true Christian, that I am doing what God wants me to do if I'm ungrateful or if I'm unthankful? I don't believe you can. Go to Philippians chapter number 2, if you would. Philippians chapter number 2. Paul, in his letter to the Philippian church, he makes clear to them how important it is that we be thankful people. And I'll tell you, when you're thankful, people see it, don't they? People are able to see you as a thankful person. You ever given somebody a gift and I mean, you really thought long and hard about it, what you were going to give them, and you got it for them, and you was excited, and you gave it to them, and their look on their face was like, thanks. You're like, okay. You know, let me have a gift back. Let me send it back and the money back. In Philippians 2 and verse 13, it says, "For it is God which worketh in you, both to will and to do of His good pleasure. Do all things without murmurings and disputings, that you may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom you shine as lights in the world." Now, we've used this verse quite often here, but I want you to think about it. That you may be blameless and harmless or innocent as the children of God. I want you to be blameless. I want you to be innocent as children of God. Well, how do I get to that point? Well, part of that, if you go back to verse 14, is I do all things without murmurings and disputings. And see, I've got to ask for forgiveness this morning because I have murmured and I have disputed over this stupid thing. Sorry, this thing. whether or not it works, I feel like a cow when I've got this on. I can't breathe, and God bless y'all, because if y'all still got yours on, and I feel sorry for you. And I have griped, and I have complained. But you know, at the end of the day, who really cares? What does it really matter? There's things in our lives that we do a lot of grumbling, and whining, and complaining, and moaning, and groaning about. Paul says, do all things without murmurings and disputings. It is so easy to get caught up in the trap that all I want to do is moan and groan and gripe and complain. Now, I understand it's going to happen somewhere along the line in your life that you're going to be upset, you need to vent, you're going to be mad about something. Listen, I don't know that he's saying that every once in a while, you know, you need to vent to somebody. But if you live your life looking for reasons to be upset, if you live your life looking for reasons to be mad and to be angry, and everybody's against me and the whole world's trying to take me over, and I mean, it's just constant, this kind of thing, where's your mindset at? Who, by the way, who is in control of the world? Now, Satan is the god of this world, but who's in control of the world? God is. So at the end of the day, it is God's, go back to verse 13, it is God which works in you both to will and to do of His good pleasure. It's God who works in me. As a child of God, that's who I belong to. Therefore, I do all things without murmurs and disputings. I'm not groaning and moaning and complaining about every little thing. Do you know people that do? Do you know those who moan and groan about everything? I mean, it doesn't matter. It don't matter what you give them. It doesn't matter what you bring to them. It doesn't matter how much you do for them. They still grind. You didn't do enough. Oh, you mowed my yard for free? Thank you very much. But you didn't weed it. And you didn't trim the hedges. You didn't sweep the grass off the sidewalk. You didn't blah, 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 blah. You know, you get my point. We as Christians need to do all things without murmurs and disputings. Quit moaning and groaning about every little thing and trying to find fault in everything that you come across. It's important that we realize that we, as children of God, are to be thankful for all things, for what God has given us, what He's blessed us with, what He has shared upon our lives. It's easy to think sometimes that the reason I am so blessed, the reason that I have so much in my life, is because of how good of a person, how good of a worker that I am. There couldn't be nothing further from the truth many times. What do you have that you did not receive? When you start and stop and think about that, and think about what do you have that you did not receive. That makes me go back to thinking, well, I need to be more thankful to God because He has chosen to give me all this goodness. He has chosen to give me all these blessings. And some would say, well, now, wait a minute, Johnny, that's not right, because look how hard I've worked for what I've got. I believe you. But let me ask you a question. Where did you get the strength to work? Well, I got it myself. Where'd you get it at? Well, the food and stuff that I ate made me strong. Well, where'd you get the food at? Well, the grocery store. Well, how'd you get it? Well, I bought it. With what? Money? Where'd the money come from? I mean, you just keep going and going and going. What blessing do you have that did not come from God? Nothing. Everything comes from Him. So when I realize that and realize that every good and perfect gift cometh down from the Father above, James 1:17, then I can recognize that what I have, I did receive. If you go to 1 Corinthians 3:7, it asks that question, what do you have that you did not receive? So as a child of God, I mean, I must be thankful. I have to be. I've got to be thankful. That's part of it. Because I'm thankful for what all God has done for me, and I'm thankful for what all God is doing with me. Thank God I'm not the man that I used to be, right? Thank God that He's made me better, that He's made me stronger, that He's made me more like His Son. As a child of God, I must be thankful. And y'all can't stress that enough, what we've been given. Do you remember in Luke chapter 17, you had 10 lepers that Jesus came upon, and those 10 lepers said, "Lord Jesus, have mercy on us," and He did. He said, "Go show yourself to the priest." And as they turned to go, they all were healed of their leprosy. It was a death sentence to have leprosy. You're going to die a horrific death. Body parts are going to start falling off eventually. Ears, your nose, your arms, your legs. I mean, you were going to die. These guys were healed, all 10 of them. And there was one that turned around and came back and thanked Him for what He did for him. Jesus was very thankful for the one that turned around and thanked Him, and He asked the question, were there not 10 cleansed? Were there 9? If we're not careful, we get to thinking that I deserve everything I got. I deserve everything that God's given me. I deserve the forgiveness of sins. I deserve that blood of Jesus on the cross. I deserve it. No, you didn't. Neither did I. And we never, ever, ever will deserve what He did for us. So we should be eternally thankful to God for what He does for me. All right, let's talk about that. Let's go to point number 2. Because I am eternally thankful to God, because I am thankful for what He's done for me, I need to show forth the praises of Him. I need to show by my works how thankful I am. You see, it's one thing to say that I'm thankful, isn't it? It's another thing to be thankful. Now, if I'm thankful, it's going to show by the way that I live. Correct? Is it going to show that? Okay, if we go back to our text, really, Philippians chapter number 2 and verse 15, that you may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation among whom you shine as lights in the world. You shine as lights in the world. Well, I tell you, this is written in the first century, and they needed some light in the world at the time. We live in the 21st century. Do we need any light in our world today? There's a lot of doom and gloom in our world today. Doom and gloom. We need some people with light. You see, at the end of the day, even though, you know, there's certain things about life that we're all interested in, at the end of the day, what's really important is this. Right? You see, that's just like my mask. My mask says I love America. And I do love America. I would not want to live anywhere else. We have the greatest place in the world. We also have a lot of sin in our world, in our country. There's a lot of problems, a lot of issues. But you know, if America were to fall, that should not change my faith in God. That should not change my thankfulness to God. Because it doesn't matter where I live, it doesn't matter what I have, that my thankfulness to God should be apparent. And I show forth my thankfulness by how I live, by how I treat other people, by how I conduct myself. People need to be able to see in me that I'm thankful, that I'm a thankful person. I didn't coin this phrase, but I'm sure somebody did, and I just heard it over the years. But we need to have the attitude of gratitude, right? We need to have that attitude where we're grateful. We're grateful. We're so thankful for what we have. And as long as I don't get to where I'm thinking too highly of myself, when I really step back and think about what all I have, I should have that attitude of gratitude. And as such, I show forth that to the people in my world. I mean, I show that to my kids. I show that to the people I work with. I show that to the people that I come in contact with at Walmart, I'm thankful. I'm grateful for the life that God has given me. The church, the children of God, we have got to show the world that we are thankful for what God's done for us. If we're moaning and groaning, if we're whining and complaining, then the world looks at us and they're like, I don't need that. Why do I need that? I'm already doing that myself. But we need to definitely be thankful for what God has given us, and as such, show forth that to the world. Look over, if you would, to Colossians chapter number 1. Colossians chapter number 1, beginning with verse number 11. Colossians 1 and verse 11, Paul writes these words to the church at Colossae. He says, strengthen with all might, according to his glorious power, unto all patience and longsuffering, with joyfulness. Now notice, patience and longsuffering. Okay, you just keep on keeping on, no matter what happens, with joyfulness. Verse 12, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. Giving thanks unto whom? Unto the Father, unto God. For what reason? Because he has made us meet, he has made us worthy to be partakers of this inheritance of the saints in light. I do not deserve what God has done for me. I didn't deserve the sacrifice that Christ made on the cross for me. I've never been good enough in my entire life to deserve one drop of that blood that he shed on the cross. But because of the grace of God, he has made me sanctified. He has made me meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. It's because of his goodness. It's because of his love that I have the opportunity to be a saint. In verse number 13, he goes on to say, who had delivered us from the power of darkness and translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Should I be thankful to God? Absolutely. And because of that, because of the ability to be thankful to God, he has made me a partaker of the, verse number 12, the inheritance of the saints in light. Jesus, in the great Sermon on the Mount, tells us what in Matthew chapter 5 and verse number 14. He says, you are the light of the world. Who's he talking to? He just talking to the regular person on the street? No, he's talking about people that follow him, that obey him. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill that cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, that it giveth light to all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. So yeah, we have the opportunity to show forth by our lives. People can see it because we're different. Because we're different. We're not the ones that are moaning and groaning and whining and complaining and blah, blah, blah. We're the ones who are excited about every little thing. We're thankful for another day of life. I know you've heard that many times, and I've heard it too. And, you know, people say, well, I'll be thankful we put our 2 feet on the floor this morning. That's true. Because there's a lot of people that died last night. Maybe not in Hornwall, but throughout the world, people died during the night. It happens. Could be my turn to not. I mean, who knows? I'm thankful that I'm alive. I'm thankful that God has given me another day of life. And I need to show that. And people need to see that. So number one this morning, as children of God, we need to be thankful. I mean, you really need to be thankful. Number two, because you're thankful, that needs to show forth through your life. In every dealing that you have with every person that you come in contact with, that needs to show in your life. Number three. With this, because of what you're doing, because you're showing forth the praises of Him that called you out of darkness into His marvelous light, because of your example, you can draw other people to Jesus. You know, you are called an ambassador of God in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 by verse number 20 and 21. You're an ambassador of God. And as such, you need to be drawing people to Jesus. You need to be bringing people to Him. Well, I'm going to tell you, you're not going to bring a whole lot of people to Jesus if you're down and out and moping and groping all the time. Moaning and groaning. That's just not going to happen. If you're excited, if you're thankful, if you're really excited about what God's done for you and you're enthusiastic about what He's done for you, then you can share that with other people. Excuse me. Yet that enthusiasm will breed enthusiasm. If you're excited about what God has done for you and you're thankful really for what He's done for you, you can tell other people and other people will get excited. Now, not everybody. Some people will not be excited at all about that. They don't hear it. But not everybody wanted to listen to Jesus either. And yet He brought this hope, this light, this opportunity for people to be saved, for people's lives to be changed. He brought that. And people did not always accept Him. Some people rejected Him. But as a child of God, through our thanksgiving, the world can be drawn to God. In Matthew chapter 18, Jesus gives an example of forgiveness. And we use it a lot when we're talking about forgiveness. But think about this for just a moment. You've got a man who was owed, in Matthew chapter 18, beginning in verse number 23, you've got a man who was owed to his master 10,000 talents. 10,000. And depending on what version you're looking at and how people compare the units of money, it is estimated by one that I looked at years ago to be about $15 million. That's not much. I got that in my back pocket, right? I tell you, in my lifetime, no matter how hard I work, I will never make $15 million. Now, I know people that do, or people that you know, you look in the news or on TV, whatever, people make tons and tons of money, and that's fine. My point is this, if I had to pay back a loan of $15 million with interest, something would happen. But irregardless of the amount, it's showing really in this story, it's showing how much I owe God. That's what I owe Him. I owe Him something that I cannot pay. But He's been willing to forgive me. Why should I not be excited about that? Why should I not be excited? And when you read this story, you know, this guy is forgiven, and yet as soon as he's forgiven, he goes out and finds somebody that owes him 15 bucks and starts choking him on the throat and casts him into jail. He was not grateful at all. I pray that you as a Christian today, that you are grateful for what God has done for you. I pray that you're thankful for everything that Jesus Christ did for you on the cross and continues to do for you today. And I hope, my hope this morning is that we definitely can go forth and show people the light. Through our thanksgiving, through the way that we live, by the way that we conduct ourselves, that we are good ambassadors for Jesus. I pray today that if thankfulness is something that you're struggling with, that you begin today to pray to God for help. I don't know that an ungrateful, unthankful person will go to heaven. I'm not God. I don't place myself as God. But if you're not thankful for the salvation that God has given you through Jesus, if you are not grateful for what God has done for you, if you're not grateful for what people in your life have done for you, you need to pray for God's assistance. You need to pray for the great physician to heal your heart. Because as a Christian, you have to be thankful. You have to be grateful. And you should be. If it wasn't for God, where would you be? There's a song that we sing sometimes, "Without Him, I would be nothing." And let me tell you, that's exactly the truth. Without Jesus, we would be nothing. This morning, if you're not a Christian, I encourage you today to become a New Testament Christian by believing in Jesus with all your heart, by being willing this morning to repent of your sins, confess your faith in Jesus that He is the Son of God, and then be baptized for the remission of your sins. If you weren't away from the fold today, we'd encourage you to come home and make things right with Him. I definitely pray that we all be thankful for all that God has done for us. If you need God's assistance this morning, we'll be glad to pray with you and pray for you as together we stand and sing.